an age of extreme makeovers and instant gratification, one Bay Area author is taking a very different approach.
But one woman proved it can be done.
She just gave me a lot of hope.
Francine is also an author.
What she's made me realize is I need to take that next step.
But by doing things that increase your self-esteem, you grow.
Like a lot of inspiration.
Francine Ward went on to have an incredible life. Her story is truly an inspiration.
Now, do we have any survivors in the room? Only a few? Not that many, huh? Well, I'm a survivor. I am an unlikely success story. 25 years ago, had you looked at me, you would have been amazed at the fact that I am standing where I am standing today with a book in my hand, the second book on the way in September, and living a life far beyond my wildest imaginings.
You're gonna be bad, you're gonna be bold, you're gonna be wiser. You're gonna be hard, you're gonna be tough, you're gonna be stronger. You're gonna be cool, you're gonna be calm, you're gonna stay together.
This is her book, Esteemable Acts, 10 Actions for Building Real Self-Esteem. It's not a book about her life. It's a book about how she was able to turn her life around.
The essence of Esteemable Acts is small, conscious, consistent baby steps. So you don't have to let go of everything. I didn't. I mean, it was absolutely impossible. But you start somewhere.
Courage is the essence of Esteemable Acts. Esteemable Acts comes from walking through fear. And it's not about the absence of fear. I don't believe courage is the absence of fear. I believe it's about the willingness to feel the fear and do it anyway.
Francine Ward has an amazing story to tell.
When I think about my history, it almost feels like it's an out-of-body experience because it doesn't seem real. From drug-addicted, alcoholic prostitute, literally living on the streets at 18 years old, it's hard to believe that today I'm a lawyer, I'm a sober woman at 25 years of sobriety, I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a wife, I'm an author. It's hard to believe that my life is so different.
Ward is a life coach. She believes the internal battle for a healthy self-esteem is universal. Much of her audience agrees.
I'm giving other women just a little bit of empowerment.
Everyone struggles with self-esteem issues.
Ward's book is called Esteemable Acts. She says those are the things we do which make us feel good about ourselves.
When you don't feel good about yourself, you make wrong choices in terms of relationships, in terms of the jobs you settle for. You make wrong choices at every turn. And when you make a wrong choice, what then happens is it breeds that sense of being a victim.
Ward is the first to admit her message comes from her own life experience. Overcoming early drug and alcohol addictions, she used the life tools which have now become her book to get a law degree, run two marathons, and now write.
But my hope is that one thing I say will get you to a place where you can say to yourself, wow, if she can do it, I can do it. So the first lesson I'd like to share with you is that I had to stop buying into other people's opinions about who I was and what I was going to do with my life. You see, at that stage of my life, when I was at that place where I was really ready to change, which was about 28 years old, which is when I went back to school, there were more than enough people reminding me that I was an ex-hooker with a criminal record. I can't tell you how many people consistently said to me, "Who do you think you are, wanting to be a lawyer? Who do you think you are? You pay lawyers. Who do you think you are to think you could be one?" And it didn't stop there. At every stage of my life, as I was breaking through yet another barrier, there were lots of people who said, you can't do it. When I decided I wanted to run a marathon, the first one was the LA Marathon, the Honolulu Marathon. I was 42, I think it was. And the next was LA when I was 43. And there were people after people, one person after another, who kept saying to me, girlfriend, you are way too old to be running. You need to be thinking about walking that race. Well, you know what? Had I listened to them, had I bought into what they thought I should be doing, I would have been sitting on the sidelines, which is what I used to do for most of my life. Sit on the sidelines waiting for something to happen. Today I get to tell you that it's about not giving the power to who I call those dream busters. And let me just say what you probably already know. The Dream Buster can be someone in your family. It could be someone in your office. It could be your best friend. And most of the time, they don't even intentionally mean to say something that's going to discourage you. They really don't. See, I don't believe that people intentionally want to hurt me. But what happens, and this is a phrase I like to use, that you can't go to hardware stores and get oranges. See, I used to go to places, I used to go to people who were stuck in their fear and expect them to encourage me out of mind. They couldn't do it. They absolutely couldn't do it. One of the lessons I have learned was to stop giving the power to other people to dictate who I am and what I could do with my life. The next lesson I learned is stop seeing myself as a victim. Now, I don't know about you, but with a history like mine, I believed I was a victim for a very, very, very long time. And I believed I had a reason to think that way. I mean, I'm black, I'm a woman, I had a very colorful past. And as long as I had an audience, I reminded people of poor me. I mean, I had my little violin and I was playing it every opportunity I could. Anybody who would listen, I let them know what a poor, pathetic life I had. Well, I have to tell you, there's some major payoffs to being a victim, as some of you probably know. When you're a victim, number one, there's always someone to blame. Always. And I used to, for me, it was my mother who was at the top of the list. You see, she didn't burp me the right way. So it was her fault that I turned out the way I did. It was those men. They forced me to take all that money. I would have never done it. It was the war in Vietnam. It was racism. It was all kinds of stuff. I must tell you, while I definitely believe that there is a reality that racism is alive and well in 2005, I had to stop using it as an excuse to not do what I needed to do for myself. Because as long as I did, I was stuck. And again, that doesn't mean that it's not a problem, because it is. I live in, to me, one of the most bigoted areas in the country. And so what? What's that old adage that success is the sweet form of revenge or something like that? If we keep doing what we need to do for ourselves, we don't have to worry about them. Because there are going to be people that don't like you whether you're black, white, green, or yellow. They're not going to like you because of the way you dress. I had to stop seeing myself as a victim, which really meant for me I had to start making some different choices. The third lesson that I learned was that I had to really understand that this was about work. And that I could sit back and I could expect somebody to do it for me. And maybe in some cases that might happen if you're perhaps a privileged kid and you don't have to work. But for most of us, I suspect we had to do the work. Or we have to. And see, I've been one of those people forever that I wanted this much out of life. I wanted this much. And I was willing to do about this much. Anybody relate to that one ever at any time in your life? I didn't want to lift a finger. And the truth is, I believe that's part of why I drank and used for years and years, because drinking and using drugs is a great escape. It's a great way to avoid doing the work, because I could just go get wasted. And even when I wasn't drinking and using over the last 26 years, I found other ways to not do the work. But I found that if I was really going to get to the next level as I wanted to in my life, I had to be willing to do whatever was necessary. People look at me sometimes today and they say, Francine, I can't believe you have come from where you've come from. Number one, all that proves is that the message that I talk about of esteemable acts works. But if you notice, it's esteemable acts, not esteemable thoughts or esteemable feelings. There was work that had to be involved, and I had to be willing to do the work. The next lesson that I learned that I'd like to share with you is that I had to understand that failure was not the worst thing that could happen to me in my life. You know, unfortunately, we live in a culture today that tells us just that. It says that failure, making a mistake, or being rejected is the worst possible thing that could happen to any of us. Well, I have to tell you, I don't buy that one. See, I believe the worst thing that could happen to me today is that I don't try, because I'm afraid to fail, because I'm afraid I'm gonna be rejected, because I'm afraid I'm gonna make a mistake. That's the worst thing that could happen to me as a woman, as a black woman, as a business person. Because I'm afraid to fail, I end up making safe choices. Safe choices, I think, is a demon. Because it's easy to stay stuck in a job you hate. It's easy to stay stuck in a relationship you can't stand, because it's the safe choice. Self-esteem comes from having the courage to risk failure. And that was one of the lessons that I learned. I just want to share with you, I've learned this the hard way, by actually going through it. Before I became a lawyer, I failed the bar many, many, many times. I'm originally from New York. I live in California now. John Kennedy Jr. and I failed the bar every time together. Some of you might remember that. And we actually passed the bar on the same try, and we were confirmed on the same day. But I kept being in the game and being in the game until I finally was admitted to the bar. Failure was not the worst thing that could have happened to me. Not going for the dream would have